Hello, I'm Jack Rickard with EVTV. This is my compadre and consigliere, El Brain Noto.
Hey, it's good to be here.
What are we going to do today, Brain?
Well, I guess take over the world. What else are we going to do?
That's what we do every day.
And that's what we do.
It's Friday. Actually, it's Thursday.
It's Thursday. I've got a graduation to go to.
You got to go to...
drive to Lexington, Kentucky.
Not Kurt, the...
Kyle.
Kyle.
Yeah, Kyle. He's going to graduate from college, so...
And so you're going to...
Lexington, Kentucky. You know, you have to drive right through a whole bunch of whiskey distilleries on the way to Lexington.
He's getting married in July. Joel was actually mentioning that we should go.
That's what they want. You guys want to go
down
to Nashville.
A slow drive down and a slow drive back through Kentucky whiskey.
There you go.
And if we actually made a wedding along the way, so much
so
better.
So be it.
I'm on board.
Okay. Good for you.
What do we got for news?
Well, the lead story is not our most interesting story, but Bob Stempel from GM, who really got their EV program off the ground in the 90s and took over the company when it was really in the pits. I mean, GM was a mess then. He died this week. Apparently, he built an electric car in the 90s for himself.
Really? Home conversion?
Home conversion, yeah, in his garage, yeah. Huh. So he was one of us.
What side of the EV1 was he on? The pro or the anti?
You know, he was on the pro side.
He got it started, and then somebody else took over management of the company.
Exactly. Yeah, okay. He really got their electric vehicle program off the ground and shepherded it, I think, up through maybe 97 or so. And then they finally kicked him off of the board, I believe. That was kind of... 1990 is when, so they were, he was a finance guy and did a, well, they had a 1980s, they had an Electro Vet, a converted Chevy Corvette, the GM did. So he was one of us. They were talking about his belief about lithium ion batteries, and as long as you keep them in that 20% and 80% range, that they don't need a heck of a lot of management. They just kind of.
That was his take on it.
That was his take on it,
in the mid-90s.
Yes.
Well, it's still true.
It's still true. Some things that never change.
But if you want to spend a couple thousand dollars on a lot of badly designed extraneous circuitry to glom on top of them and try to set them on fire.
Well, and it's funny.
It's all an experiment, right?
And it's funny to read the EVTV
list. Well, defend the death, you're right to do so.
That's right. And it's funny to read the list. The EVDL last week, you know, broke out in... Guys, you know, they just don't know what to do, so they'll build their own. They're just going to drop circuits across the top of their batteries.
Yep, at random.
At random, yeah. Just come up with something.
It's now everybody's going to design their own BMS since you can't trust any of them that are out there.
Yeah, just build
your
own.
We're all just going to randomly throw semiconductor components on top of these very durable batteries.
Yeah, nice batteries. Just glom them on.
It's amazing.
What else this week? We did talk a couple of weeks, or actually over the past couple of weeks, about Enerdell. They had replaced their CEO and new president, all that stuff. Well, it looks like their quarterly report didn't look that good for the first quarter.
You know why?
Well, I think, did I say think? Did they lose the think account? Was part of it?
That really wasn't it.
What was it?
They gave back Think 31% of their stock and took it as a zero value write down. Rather than sell me batteries,
right?
They would rather do a big deal where they buy the company in order to sell them the batteries. Fisker is using A123.
Yeah,
that's not because Fisker decided A123 was the best battery.
No, didn't they get a chunk of them?
Yes. Fisker A123 put $30 or $40 million in them.
Fisker,
and similarly, Enerdell invested $59 million in 31% of Think, which can't sell a very barely an overgrown neighborhood electric vehicle for $33,000, I think. And so they're not selling the cars, they're not buying the batteries. And
there goes the plan.
And basically, SEC regulations being what they are, it was actually better to take a write down now on the entire value of their investment in Think, $59 million, and get it off the books.
Just get it done with.
So they tendered their shares, which represented 31% of Think, to the company and kind of gifted them back.
Gifted them to them. Oh, man. What a nightmare.
So that's why the huge hit. But this is the same. Interdell has some promising technology. A123, anytime we talk to them about the batteries, they indicate that they think that their batteries requires a certain level of engineering expertise to properly design a module for.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, to be safe and effective. And, you know, I guess when I hear that, what I hear is that they probably know their product best.
Yeah, they probably do. Yeah, and it.
If they don't think it's appropriate for me to engineer a battery solution from their cells, I'm guessing they're probably right.
That's right. We just have
their cells probably are not sufficiently robustly designed for me to have any interest in the first place.
Yeah.
And so I don't press it too hard. But these companies are, they're not selling the batteries to anybody. They're doing big deals that don't come to fruition and eating investor money and government money, too, now. That A123 would take money from the United States government and then post on their website that if you are a hobbyist or a doing a custom car, that they have no interest in even hearing from you by email, is technically treason.
Yeah,
or fraud. And I think that these people handing out the money ought to take a look at what these guys are doing with it and what they want to. It's mostly an exercise in trying to develop intellectual property and sell it.
Roll it up and sell it.
They don't really want to sell any batteries. And that's why we've kind of fallen in with the Chinese battery producers. They'll actually sell us batteries.
Mm-hmm. We have a lot of their batteries.
And so it's not a matter of intellectual property. Meanwhile, their batteries are getting out there. They're getting reports on the batteries. Mm-hmm. They're improving the batteries. People are becoming familiar with how to deal with the batteries.
Right.
And you're going to wind up using Chinese batteries, and that's why.
That's why. Yep. Yep.
Well, that's just the way it is. So what's next?
Well, there was an interesting situation that happened apparently in one of the ports in Germany.
Mm-hmm.
Someone imported a Wego into Germany.
Yeah?
Apparently, the Germans can't sue the Chinese over any infringement on the Wego design.
But it looks a lot like a smart car.
Yeah, so Daimler has been kind of mad, but they really can't do anything because the Chinese just tell them, well, it's not a smart car.
Mm-hmm.
However, when it landed in port, they immediately got a forklift,
mm-hmm.
ran the forklift through the windshield and then through the side of the car and just fixed that problem.
So they accidentally ran it through the windshield from the front.
Right, backed up. Came around the other side
and came in from the side and accidentally got it again.
Yeah.
You know, there's industrial accidents happen.
Things like that all. And they don't have OSHA over there, you know. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So things like that happen all the time.
Let's talk about that. Wego is on the ropes. They need investor capital to continue production.
Yeah, that's what I understand. Yeah.
I think Coda actually picked up a modest amount to make it to the next month or something. But they're among the walking dead.
Same thing,
Think is dying. Again, I'm heavily invested in Tesla, so take this with a grain of salt.
Yeah, this full disclosure.
Full disclosure. A lot of electric car companies are failing. And mm-hmm. what this has done is set up a very interesting investment situation. Right now, Tesla's stock, 35% of the float is sold short.
Yeah, that's what we were talking about. Yeah, that's amazing.
Go look up short squeeze. This is one of my favorite play in stocks. Because all these companies are struggling, surely Tesla will go out of business. And when it does, the stock you sell at $29, mm-hmm. you can buy back at $4 and cover. Mm-hmm. You get to keep the difference. That's $25
a share.
Yeah. It's good work if you can get it. Mm-hmm. Here's what happens if some other people have that idea too. You all go out and sell stock. You don't really have the stock. So you borrow it from the broker. He's supposed to have it. Guess what?
Yeah, he doesn't either.
He doesn't really have it either.
No. He doesn't have it. He'd have to buy it.
So it's kind of like printing new stock.
Yeah.
And it kind of is inflationary. And you wind up, you know, with the price of the stock somewhat artificially depressed by the short sale.
Yeah, right.
Now, yep. Here's the problem with the short sale. There is no limit to the losses. If I buy a stock at $29 and it goes to zero, I've lost $29.
Right.
But that's as much as I can lose.
Right.
If I sell it short at $29 and it goes to 100, mm-hmm. I've lost 71
bucks. Yeah.
If it goes to 200, it's 171.
Yeah.
If it went to 500, it would be 471.
Yeah, that's right.
There is no limit to the losses. And so a lot of these guys, it's kind of a margin situation. Mm-hmm. They don't really.
They're not using their own money.
Right.
Yeah.
They take that money and invest it that they got from the sale and put it in other stocks. Mm-hmm. And then they get a margin call. They have a forced cover. Mm-hmm. So if you have a stock that everybody thinks is going down, let's say it's $25 a share, and a bunch of people have sold it short, and it doesn't go down, then if it goes up a little bit, a lot of times they'll double down and sell short
again.
Yeah. Because they know it's going down. Now, if it goes up a little bit more, they start to lose money. At some point, they get a margin call, but usually before that, they start eyeing this account and saying, look, I sold this at 25, it's up to 29. If I sold it short here, that would split
I'd
be in at 27. They do that. Now it's 31. Wait a minute. This isn't working too good.
No.
And so they start to tiptoe out. Let's cover and move on to the next one. The problem is that then they have to go buy the stock that they bought.
Right.
That makes the price go up. Now, more of them are looking at this rising price, and they start to panic. It's called a short squeeze, and they start to buy to cover, to limit their losses.
And the stock goes up.
The stock goes up far beyond what it really warrants.
What it was going
You have the normal demand for the stock, and now you have the short squeeze panic pumping it. And they have to buy a stock and cover, and they have to do it before it goes up anymore.
Yeah.
And it gets to be a race for the exits. It's my favorite play.
The short
to be
squeeze.
Sitting there. I love to be sitting there with calls on the stock when that happens. You have to be able to knowledgeably sort the wheat from the chaff. Notice I'm not heavily invested in WeGo, Coda, or Think.
Right.
I believe Elon Musk and the Tesla team are executing on all cylinders and are going to deliver a marvelous car. And I think that, as the popular thinking is, 99% of the car companies that are purporting to do electric cars are not going to make it.
No, I don't think
35%
so.
35% of Tesla's float is out short. I own these people.
It's amazing.
I just haven't cashed in.
No.
But I already own them.
Yeah.
I get the money they were going to send kids to college on.
Yeah, they're sending brokers to jail anyway.
Yeah. No, they should. Cree announced this week an interesting thing. Maybe I have to explain it to some of you, but most of you will know what I'm talking about. Cree makes some interesting, and talk about an investment play. This company does some heavy-duty R&D into some very interesting areas.
Okay.
High-voltage MOSFETs, it comes to mind. Normally use IGBTs for higher voltage applications and MOSFETs, which have very low forward resistance for anything that's within the voltage range of MOSFETs, which is kind of limited. But Cree's been doing some work with 1,200, 1,300 volt MOSFETs.
Oh, wow.
They also are probably most famous for their work with light emitting diodes.
Mm-hmm.
A light emitting diode converts electricity to light somewhat directly, and so with some efficiency. Cree has just announced a 231 lumen per watt laboratory achievement with an LED.
Per watt, wow.
And at a fairly low 375 milliamp test rate. You know, we all appreciate electric lights. They're part of our life. They're not very efficient devices. Thomas Edison is largely credited in America with the invention of the electric light bulb. There were probably 20 or 25 people going back to 1804 who had actually done successful experiments with incandescent lights.
Yeah.
Thomas Edison kind of developed a whole system and deployed electric lights in the United States first. About the same time as an Englishman named Joseph Swan. He actually invented a light bulb and put in a hydroelectric dam at his house and had his house lit up probably a year before Edison's patent. It converts electricity to electromagnetic waves, and among them light, and predominantly among them heat.
Yeah.
And so an incandescent light bulb, a 100 watt bulb, is a little more efficient than like a 60 or 40 with a tungsten filament, not with the bamboo, carbonized bamboo that Edison
was using.
made famous. Will do about 17 and a half lumens per watt of input electricity. That's about a 2.6% efficiency.
Okay, not very efficient, yeah.
And that's mostly what Lights America is, a tungsten. You'll recall our first video, I talked about Cree and LEDs and some of their work, and how President Obama had called on each one of us to change a light bulb from incandescent to compact flash.
CFC.
And I noted that my father built a home in 1959 entirely with tube fluorescence.
Yeah,
and would not allow incandescence until I was probably 10 or 12 years old. Mother finally made him put in a lamp or something. Kind of a harsh light in those days. They're much better now. That kind of a T12 fluorescent tube, you can do about 60 lumens on a good one out of per watt.
Okay, that's getting a lot better.
That's about 8%, almost 9%, 8.78% efficient. Your new compact flash, compact fluorescence now, will do 75 lumens, about 11% efficient.
Okay.
A lot of people don't know them, and I love these things. But they're kind of pricey, but a lot of street lights are done with this. A high-pressure sodium bulb, which is also like a metallic gas.
Are those the kind of orange, yellowish looking ones
The big orange ones are like a street lamp
Or
something. 150 lumens per watt. That's about 22%. The new LED replacement light bulbs you see? Those are about 82 lumens or 12%. 100% efficiency would be nominally 683 lumens per watt.
Per watt, okay.
Now, there's efficiency and there's effective efficiency. That 683 lumens would be at 555 nanometers, or kind of about the color of
like
your
this,
green stripe.
Like the green light,
It's a green light. We like white lights, and that's you know, going to be a little different. What this really is you're talking about narrowing the band of emission. Less heat, less red, and more white, usable light. That it all, the electricity gets converted, it just gets converted into useless things, like heat.
Heat,
And your incandescent bulb, There's a huge heat component to it. It's mostly heat.
Yeah.
It's a heater that gives off light. And this increases your load on your air conditioning too. Mm-hmm. So they're not very energy efficient. I'm not a big fan of government control of these things. They're going to phase out the incandescent bulbs. You will not be able to purchase them after 2014.
Yeah. I know. Yep. Stock up now.
But realistically, they're 2.6% efficient. Your LED replacement bulb would be 12%. Your compact flash would be 11%. And I tell you all this to put this Cree thing in perspective. We have the technology. We don't have the economies of scale or the pricing yet to do 231 lumens per watt. Right now, they have demonstrated it. And that's more like 33.8%.
Getting up there, yeah.
Why has this got anything to do with electric vehicles? Well, it doesn't entirely. I just like electrical things. Yeah, but when you talk about the grid and its future ability to support cars, note that if we went from 2.6% efficiency to 33.8% efficiency on all the lights in the United States of America, you have unlimited electric vehicles forever.
At that point. Yeah, exactly.
You could have six times the number of cars that we have and they'd be electric.
Yeah.
And the grid would never see it. Never mind the disparity between afternoon and early morning and so forth, just by changing with a little bit more vision than Obama's compact fluorescent. If we could get behind this, and this is not something that needs a great deal of research, it needs a great deal of engineering and some investment.
Right.
Cree makes LEDs. Some of them are quite high efficiency. This one now they've achieved 231 lumens per watt in mostly white.
Wow.
You know,
that's what
and
we
that,
need.
That difference is not small potatoes. You know, sometimes we look at the wrong things. Everybody looks at the oil. How about looking at the number of cars?
You're right. Yeah.
Everybody looks at how hard it is to produce electricity with solar and with wind. You know, it's actually not that hard, but there is another end to it. How about not using as much electricity?
Not using as much, yeah.
And I'm not talking about suffering and giving up. How about let's technologically, we can move with the stuff that's on the ground. It's been demonstrated what we've seen with our own eyes. This is not a guess. This is not about the future. This is not Star Trek. With what's on the table right now, we could go from 2.6% efficiency to 33.8% efficiency nationally on light.
Yeah, just on light bulbs.
This is non-trivial, people. This is a huge amount of energy that we're talking about on a continental scale. It's like thousands of megawatts. This is a Carl Sagan billions and billions moment.
Yeah.
Right? Just with a change in how we light things using technology that's on the ground. You can't go to Lowe's and buy it right now.
No.
We would have to do some stuff, but we don't have to invent science fiction.
Right.
We can make light 231 lumens per watt. We can also do it at 17.5 lumens per watt.
Mm-hmm. It's still better.
And there's 300 million of us doing it. And so this is why the arguments over where the electricity comes from and where, you know, how we're going to support all these electric vehicles, I can't spend a lot of mental energy talking about that. It's a silly conversation.
Yeah.
I already know how it comes out. We don't need to worry about it. And, you know, it's just not why get drugged down in a mire with people arguing about fantasies.
Mm-hmm.
Similarly, the oil, the price of oil is of interest to me. How much oil they can produce or not produce, I've told you many times. If you'll give me $100 a gallon, I can make you all the oil you want.
Oh, yeah.
You know, it's not about how much you make, it's how much will you pay.
How much will you pay, yeah.
And, give me $100 a gallon for gasoline, and I'll deliver it.
Yeah, a lot of people will.
And I'll never run out.
Yeah.
Until I want 200.
Yeah, that's right.
And so you're kind of looking at the wrong place. Here's where the problem is. 1900 to 1995, 500 million cars. 1995 to 2010, another 400 million.
Mm-hmm. That's a quick change.
2010 to 2020, the other 600 million.
Yeah, that's a lot fast.
It's an exponential growth curve in the number of cars. The oil doesn't matter. You can't afford it. You're competing with everybody on the planet.
Right, that's it. It's a commodity.
And, you know, it's kind of like Shah Agassi says, we didn't leave the Stone Age because we ran out of stones.
That's right.
We didn't leave the Bronze Age because it couldn't make bronze. It's time to move on.
Time to move on.
And actually, the low cost of gasoline is what's held us back. Mm-hmm. But fortunately, I think those days are gone. So this was something to think about. What does it mean that CREE can make 231 lumens per watt? It means that we can do 16 times what we do with the same amount of electricity we produce today.
Yep.
Or another way would be 2.6 into 33.8. Yeah, about a dozen times.
Mm-hmm.
We can burn 1/12 the electricity we do now.
Right. Instead of try to produce 12 times the electricity and keep everything the same.
That's on the lighting. We also reduce our air conditioning load, which is another big portion of our electric consumption, simply by not making that same electricity available as heat, which we do with an incandescent light bulb.
Yeah, you're trying to like you're cooling an oven of light bulbs.
So my father was about, 50 years ahead of his time. And understood this fairly well then. I've got a pretty good grasp of it. You guys need to catch up. What else we got?
Well, that's pretty it for the news.
All right. Let's talk about the, let's go look at some stuff. We've had a pretty good week this week.
Yeah, we did.
As you all may have, we've been struggling here the last few weeks to put together a stunning show. We're waiting on a lot of parts and things. And we've got several exciting projects. I'm very, we're going to have a lot of fun here. But we have to order parts. We have to decide on parts.
So you have to order vehicles and all kinds
of
stuff.
And this doesn't, and you're going to encounter this with your own conversion. It's the weekend you're ready to go work on everything. You don't have the parts
you have
need,
anything.
The tools you need, and so on and so forth. But they'll have you that there in 60 days.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's part of the thing. We've gotten kind of cavalier about it. We're accustomed to it, and we've done enough of these that there'll be more parts than tomorrow, you know.
Yeah.
But
hopefully the ones you need.
So one of the biggies, you've seen our test bench, Cadillac Escalade, sponsored by the Winston Battery Company.
There we go.
This is a big project and a big one for me personally. We're not going to produce this car. We don't expect you to do a Escalade conversion. This is going to be my ride with air conditioning and heat and kind of a demonstration that you don't have to limit yourself to just, you know, you can do any size vehicle. Up to and including an aircraft carrier, electric drive, and it'll work fine. We've been waiting on Lucien, my enormous Polish machinist friend, and Igor,
our
to
his
do
Russian
a fabulous front adapter plate to carry our air conditioning compressor and our power steering pump.
We have been waiting a while.
We're going to use the power steering pump to drive both the steering and the power brakes.
Right.
And so we're not going to have a noisy vacuum pump in the car, and we're going to go to those HydroBoost brakes, and that pump will power both of those. And we're using the stock air conditioning compressor. Now on this environmental system, which I've cast as number one priority on this project,
right.
as long as you heat and cool me, you're forgiven if it won't move.
If it doesn't move, if it stays on the lift.
But I want to sit in the driveway and stay cool or warm.
That's right.
And so this is my habitat. And so by using the stock air compressor that way, the environmental system in the truck doesn't know that there's been any change.
It doesn't care, no.
It sends an electrical signal to turn on the clutch on that compressor, and away it goes.
Yep.
Recently, we did a thing on our hot water heat thing, mm-hmm. and that's the other input to that.
Yeah.
And so again,
it doesn't care.
Our environmental system doesn't know there's not a 6.2 liter.
Right. It's just getting compressed.
We don't have to fake any signals. No. We don't have to do anything. It's the same air conditioning system, the same hot water heating system, except it's not connected to an internal combustion engine. Lucian and Igor showed up this week.
They did.
And they tagged me. But they did such a good job of it, I really don't mind paying. Let's take a look at what we've got to show on the front, the other end of our twin 11-inch motor.
All right.
Okay, I'm here with my enormous Polish friend, Lucian, how do you do that?
Zielinski.
You know, I've got a skirt check here now.
Yeah, I met skirt check yesterday.
Yeah. Lucian is with Kate Precision Machines, and he's informed me that I now owe him my house. This has been a little bit of an expense, but it's kind of an important part of what we're doing. If you recall, I was mainly concerned about the air conditioning and the heating working, and if we got the vehicle to move as a byproduct, that would be acceptable too. Here's our air conditioner. We're going to run this off of a belt on the end of our Jamerico twin 11-inch motors. And how to come up with that has been kind of an issue. And part of it is just me being picky. And part of it is they didn't have much of a go-by. But I wanted, this is our steering pump. I want to be able to change the steering pump. Here's the air conditioning compressor. I want to be able to change that easily. And he's actually stamped in here the number of a standard Napa belt. So they had to do all this and pick a standard belt size that I can go in and get off the rack. A lot of guys do this, do a custom belt, well then they can't find the second one they bought later. They have to have a belt made up to get it going again. I don't like having a belt in an electric car in the first place, but if I have to have one, it needs to be one I can get off the rack. Lucian, what do you got going here?
Well, Jack, what we started out with when we initially met and you came up with this idea of what we needed to do. We had to adapt the air conditioning compressor power steering pump and figure out how to take the pulleys and get the correct wrap on the pulleys so we wouldn't have any slippage.
Well, first we had to, well, we started with, what is this aluminum stock?
That's a 7/8 inch plate.
7/8 inch plate?
Aluminum 6061.
6061. Mm-hmm. And it was about this big and about this wide.
Well, we started out big because we didn't really know where we were going to go with it or where we needed to adapt anything.
Well, kind of the central issue was we didn't really have a pulley. And what Lucian has done, if you notice, our drive pulley looks remarkably like our power steering pump pulley. There's a reason. We gave him one off power steering pump. And he has put a, what, 7/8?
That's a 7/8 board.
And keyed.
Yeah, and it's keyed with two set screws. One set screw on the key, one 90 degree off.
So we had to bore this and get it on the center.
Well, what we did, we initially bored the old bore out, the old hub, with it on center, and then we made a bushing that pretty much kind of pressed into this one. We then welded around it, and then we came in and we initially drilled and or drilled and bored this small so that after we welded it in, then we came back putting the pulley on center, then we bored it and reamed it 7/8 to make sure that it's on center this way.
So we did, starting with a small hole and reaming it, it was kind of like being on a lathe.
Well, we did it on the lathe, and you don't want to drill a hole and then run a reamer through it because your drill could be off. So when you know this, the outside of this pulley's on center, mm-hmm. and your hole's smaller and you need to make it bigger, if you bore it, if this hole is off center or pointing the wrong way, that bore will straighten that hole out to the pulley. And then after you do that, then you run a reamer through it and it cleans it up and it gets you to the exact size that you want to be in.
So this is going to be a special piece. You're not going to be able to go down and buy one of these. However, one of the key parts of this is the reluctor ring off the crankshaft of a Cadillac Escalade engine. Now, it wasn't our engine because we didn't have it out of the truck yet, but we were able to locate one of these reluctor rings. And you've, what, tacked that on there, or how did you attach it?
The way we did that, once we had the new hub put in the pulley, mm-hmm. We made a jig that was turned down 7/8 to fit into this bore, and then the outside was turned to fit inside of this ring so that we could put them both together.
And knew it was centered.
And knew it was centered, or it's going to get you real close. And then by clamping that on after we had that jig on there, then we could turn it around and we could tack it accordingly so that it won't come off. So you have a concentric pulley now with a Prox pickup wheel that may have a thousandth of run out at the most, mm-hmm. Because you want that to be concentric. Mm-hmm.
Well, that's going to give us our RPM to our Cadillac EXT engine control unit, and it's kind of a key part of this mm-hmm. project. So the other thing was you and Igor actually had to lay out the winding of a serpentine belt. What is this, a six-rib belt?
Yes.
And that's, we kind of inherit that six-rib concept from the pulley on the power steering pump and on the air conditioning pump.
Yes.
Now, this was actually a stock. There's two tensioners on the Cadillac. And was this the big one or the little one?
No, this is the little one that Matt initially found mm-hmm. after the fact.
Yeah.
And it ended up making things easier to figure out where to put it and to mount it, because all we had to do was to pocket this 7/8 plate out. Mm-hmm. Initially, what the way this plate is mounted, there's a boss on the front of the electric motor, mm-hmm. and so there is a boss cut into this plate 1/4 inch to fit over that boss, but it's also bossed 1/4 inch to go over the outside of the motor too. So I mean, it's really on there and it's snug and it's rigid.
Mm-hmm. Then there won't be any wobble there.
No wobble.
And but then, this had to be redone. This was a stock. This was the one that was used. There's two belts on the Cadillac Escalade. We're getting it down to one. This was the one used on the air conditioner. But we have a little different roller on this. What happened?
Well, the reason we had to do that was because it was actually a 50 millimeter idler. And it was so big that it came up too close to the housing on this tensioner, so you couldn't wrap your belt around it. Mm-hmm. So we made one that's smaller. It's aluminum. It's the same size, but a smaller diameter.
Okay.
It's actually more rigid than the pressed tension idler that was on there.
Okay. So there is a boss on the motor, and then you've actually got it, recessed around the motor, and then we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 of these flathead recessed screws that bolted on, and that's on pretty good. How are we going to put this pulley on here? It's keyed, and yep. we did have a 7/8 inch shaft from Mr. Husted.
So what we're going to do, of course, we bored and reamed the pulley 7/8. It's going to fit over the shaft mm-hmm. and the key. And the pulley has a set screw on the key mm-hmm. that will clamp down on it. And it has a set screw that will go down into the side of the shaft on 90 degrees.
Okay. Can we get this on here and get her tightened down?
Yeah, we'll have to. We're going to have to work on that a little bit, Matt.
We'll have to tap it on a bigger hammer.
Yeah, we'll have to tap it on. You want to stop here, or let's see.
this tap oil, you need a piece of wood.
Yeah.
That'd be better, wouldn't it? Something about like that.
That'll work.
Yeah, keep the camera going, buddy. I do pretty good with the hammer work around here.
Okay, we're almost there. You got a little punch or something I can hit? Well, maybe this will work. Hold on. Okay.
All right.
All right, we're there. I'm going to tighten the set screws down.
All right. No, we're not rubbing on the plate, are we?
Nope, we're not rubbing on the plate.
Okay. Okay. And in my way of thinking, a big issue is to have all these lined up.
Very important.
On the same plane, or we're going to be wobbling, giving off heat, and losing energy. We want this to be as easy to turn for that motor as it can be. When it's not doing any work, of course, at times it'll be running the pump and the air conditioner. By using the same air conditioning compressor, kind of in the same place, we may have to have some hoses made up, but our environmental system will plug into the same plug, and most of the time this will just turn freely. It has an electric clutch. When it gets the signal from the environmental system, it kicks on the compressor. Now this, I can't get my head around every time you guys do.
Yeah, this takes a little bit of, you have to play with it a little bit until you figure out how the belt routing goes on it. But first it goes around the tensioner like that.
Uh-huh.
It's going to go under the drive pulley there and over the stationary idler.
Now this idler was just a stock.
That's a stock idler.
On the Cadillac.
Mm-hmm. And let's see here. Then we're going to go over this. We're going to flip this around. And the best way we found to get this belt on, I'll have to change sides with you, Jack.
Alrighty.
Is we're going to roll this on.
Mm-hmm.
So you can see
as count draws up, as you
tensioner's coming down. So mm-hmm. It's putting full tension on it. That will allow for our belt stretching and should stay on there a long time. So right now we've got a really good tight belt, everything's in alignment.
Mm-hmm.
Probably the biggest challenge to making this plate was we had to calculate how thick the spacer block needed to be on the back of this plate to position the pulley after it's pressed onto the power steering pump.
Mm-hmm.
To position it, and after we tightened everything up, that it was in line with the rest of the pulleys. And the mm-hmm. same thing with the air conditioning pump.
Mm-hmm.
We had to make sure that the hole locations were correct so that pulley lined up with all the others.
Well, really, it was kind of non-trivial. I guess this degree of wrap on these serpentine belts is somewhat important.
It's important because you don't want any slippage.
Mm-hmm. And so then to get that to work and all this on here, of course, you can't be mounted where the motor is.
Exactly.
On the backside. So we've got to be past that with this and this. So it's quite a layout program.
I know you had mentioned something yesterday about being able to change brushes out too. Is that something that you're going to still be able to do?
I think so. We'll be able to get to them. This is our brush thing. We may have to pull all this off, but that was, one of them was talking about changing the brushes. That's a 100,000 mile event.
The one good thing about the way this is designed is that if you ever needed to replace this power steering pump,
mm-hmm.
you can remove three bolts back here and the whole assembly will come out a slot out the mm-hmm. top.
And pretty same, much the same way over here.
Same with that. So everything's standard. Replacement parts is not an issue.
Mm-hmm.
So it's pretty easy to work on if you have to.
Well, that's what I want is a lot of times in doing these electric cars, you get into kind of elaborate, into your own designs. This air conditioner kind of had built-in cast mountings. I wanted it us to accommodate that, sure. Not revise this to fit our motor. So I can yank that off and take one right off the shelf and bolt it right on there. And the same with the fluid pump. Are we tightened down here?
Yeah, we're tight.
Let me see if I can get this to turn up. Let's see if we hurt anybody. Turn on our system, our blowers. Bring up our accelerator a little bit, see if we can make it turn slowly. This is looking pretty smooth to me.
I think it's going to work, Jack.
My golly, you're right. Now that we're all the way on there,
yeah.
I can look at the belt on this idler is a good place because it's kind of a round thing and it's not going back and forth at all. I'm not going back and forth across the top, and so that looks pretty much in line. Let's turn up the speed and see if it throws a belt at us. It's not making any noise at all.
It's quiet.
It's entirely silent. The blowers are making noise. My transmission and generator is making a little bit. This, and I'm wearing a microphone around my neck, leaning over this thing. It just isn't. A faint whir, if that. We're not striking anything with our belts. So I'm going to predict that belt will last the life of the car. If you've got everything lined up, the belts are a lot better than they were in 1960.
No, absolutely. V-belts.
Yeah, the old V-belts. You got to change them a lot. I do like these rib serpentine belts a little better, but we try to limit what we put on an electric car for maintenance items and a belt, but I'm gonna have belts and hoses all over this one. Cadillac Escalade, let me crank it up a little. You can also see that our test bench is not precisely a piece of laboratory equipment. It actually kind of gets to be a workbench where we can work all this out. If you're putting a stock motor on a stock transmission and hooking up some cables, it's okay to do it in the car, and that's normally where you want to do it. We have so many unknowns on this that I wanted to do it out here where we can get to it,
sure.
Play with it. Put it on, take it off, put it on, take it off, put it on, take it off, put it on, take it off. Not that we did that. Well, actually, we did.
Yeah, we did a couple of times.
Yeah. and be able to get to it and see what's going on. Now we drop, take all that apart, put it in the truck, it'll all go right together. So that was kind of the concept of the test bench, was really to work out what we're going to have working in the car and have it all working. And then we'll move it.
right. rather than trying to build it from underneath a 7,000 pound truck over the top of our heads.
Sure, sure.
Well, that looks pretty good. I like it. It spins free. And it looks good. I think it'll be maintainable. We'll be able to exchange parts. We use a standard Napa belt, actually. Let me put this on camera so later I can come back and find it after I lose the box. This is a Napa 25060705 belt, 71 1/8 inches. I believe what Igor told me. Yeah. Now I've got that on video.
And it's stamped.
And we have that stamped right here on the plate. That's an important point. I had them take the little stencil things and stamp that right here in the plate. So 12 years from now, I can still find that part number, and hopefully they'll be able to look it up and see what the new replacement is for it by then.
That's right.
So it looks pretty good. This kind of custom machine work, a lot of you do at home, and it is an area where you can save a lot of money. How much money did they save if they did it themselves, Lucia?
Oh, probably about $3,600.
Yes, $3,600 is about that. But you kind of had to engineer this. Now, we're using an 11-inch motor and two General Motors devices here, and a reluctor ring. This is kind of a special assembly, but if one of our viewers needed kind of this package, now that it's in the computer, what would it cost them?
Oh, Jack, I haven't really thought about it yet, but I mean, you know, the initial prototyping is what costs, because I mean, it's something that's never been done before, so there's a lot of CAD work, there's tool path that has to be built and generated to cut and drill holes in the correct position so that everything bolts up like it does. You know, you're probably talking $1,500, maybe closer to $1,800 with the brackets and everything.
Okay.
The brackets are special for the AC pump just because the gussets are made into the brackets themselves. It's just a really good rigid design.
Okay.
And it's all aluminum.
I'm very pleased with it. You trimmed it down, got rid of a bunch of weight from that original thing. It looks good. It runs quietly and it runs straight. I'm happy. The cruelty of it is that when you do a one-off car like this, you get to pay twice. Once to tool up for it and once to have the device. But if any of you need a 11-inch motor plate to run an air conditioner and a steering pump, certainly on the GM cars, but really these are an air conditioning compressor is an air conditioning compressor, and a power steering pump's a power steering pump. If you get this bracket and these two, you're kind of there, whatever vehicle you're using with an 11-inch thing. So you can call Kate Precision Machine, and Lucian will be happy to treat you a lot better than he did me, and there's a reason for that. Again, if you can do this kind of work yourself, that's a big cost savings. However, it's just the kind of place to get into trouble on this. This is where you get wear items, vibration items, and that sort of thing. So I personally prefer to hook up with not just a professional machine shop, but usually a CNC type operation, where then I've got the design in the computer. And we could redesign this by calling that up and doing some changes in it.
You can always change things.
So that's kind of a personal philosophy thing. If you're doing one on a budget, you may want to try this. There's no particular part of it that can't be done. But for me, I get a better result quicker. And we've got just some great machine shops in the area. And so it's not much point in me making an ugly one when I can get a pretty one from Lucien.
Thank you, Jack.
And the big thing is to get it where it's balanced and in line. If you get it and it works at first, that little wobble or that little extra tension is just, you can build a 7,500 mile car kind of easily. And it looks like it's doing okay when you first put it together and run it. But about 7,500 miles and that part comes unraveled because it really wasn't.
Cracks.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, I'm thinking less about cracks and more about vibrations. Mm-hmm. Little things out of line, they start to wobble, and that causes wear that it wouldn't normally have
right.
if it was lined up right. Just the
exactly.
the running of
belts,
it.
Everything.
Exactly. You wind up replacing the belt every 5,000 miles because, you know, every trip around it nicks this thing just by a little bit, and you don't notice that. And so for me, I mean, a lot of our viewers are very mechanically adroit. I'm not. And so I constantly am watching this sort of thing because those are the ones that I get to revisit a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And so we've done, well, you've been involved in our mini escapades with the mini.
Mm-hmm.
and they were mechanical issues largely. That we just didn't have right the first time and had to keep after. Anyway, this looks great. I'm very pleased with it. The Cadillac Escalade project is accelerating. Our batteries are on order and, in fact, on the water. And, in fact, we got our battery box in this week, and we're going to take a look at that here in a few minutes. Lucien, thank you. This is an artistic piece of work, I think. It's just beautiful. And we're kind of enough into an unusual vehicle with this Cadillac Escalade
mm-hmm.
that I'm kind of making jewelry here. I want it to
exactly.
really look good.
Sure.
And because it's just too damn expensive
right.
to
exactly.
have an ugly one
that's
when
right.
we get done. and this is fitting right in here. It's very quiet. And and that air conditioning compressor is virtually silent when it's not compressing.
Mm-hmm.
So these are kind of dummies. The real relatively new air compressor and steering pump are still on the vehicle. We're going to use that one. I've only got, I think, 5,000 miles on that truck. These were some I picked up on eBay so you'd have something to play with. And that's another reason I wanted them to be easy to
mm-hmm.
change.
Mm-hmm.
So anyway, thanks for being with us on another project. And if you all need an end plate for an 11-inch motor, give Lucien a call. And he'll put together some, he and Igor will put together some pretty good stuff for you.
All right, thank you, Jack.
Thank you, buddy.
Evnetics Electric Vehicle Systems presents the Soliton One Controller. 1,000 amps of continuous power at up to 340 volts. Enough power to drive your dream car while automatically protecting your precious battery pack. Built-in contactors and pre-charge circuit reduces parts count. Each Soliton One controller undergoes rigorous dynamometer qualification. An easy-to-use web interface configuration with real-time data logger through an Ethernet connection. The only controller with programmable idle function ideal for automatic transmissions. Liquid cooling for high power operation. Evnetics Soliton 1. Very dangerous, very high voltage.
Okay, so Lucien's got us a plate.
That's pretty cool.
That thing runs slick, smooth, and it's no waste.
No, and it's quiet.
It's deadly quiet. Yeah. I liked it.
Yeah.
While we were gone, I was mentioning to Brian that I heard a statistic the other day that last year, 48.5% of all the births in America were to single parents.
Single, yeah.
unwed
single mothers.
And it brings up the question, where are all these kids going to learn? Who's going to go around from room to room waving their arms and screaming and yelling about turning out the lights to save on the utility bill?
We're sunk. We're going to have generations.
Without a father, how would you know about
that?
We're
going to have generations of people don't.
Did your dad do that prance?
Yeah, he would remark, what is your last name, Edison?
What is your last name, Edison? without a father to go room for room screaming and bellowing at the top of his lungs, what are you people trying to do to me? You're not even in these rooms. Turn out the lights. Where would you learn that?
Yeah, you wouldn't. It'll be a lost skill.
The Cadillac Escalade is picking up pace. Our batteries are on the water.
Mm-hmm.
I'm told about the 26th of May.
Okay.
My experience with this is not to, like, bring a lunch that day or something, because things happen in customs and so on and so forth. But nominally, the 26th of May. And so we, this week, got Southeast Fabricating, which is owned and operated by a man named Daniel Tote.
Mm-hmm.
Dan and I started the first grade together.
Oh, geez.
That's how far back things go in Cape. Probably 1961. 60 or 61.
Okay.
Started the first grade together, and I went down and had him make me up a battery box.
Mm-hmm.
The basic box, a false bottom and a lid. Only took him two tries.
Right, only two tries. Not bad.
About $585. We have to add some things to that for the Escalade.
Mm-hmm.
And so we did. Let's take a look.
All right.
Well, we are finally making some progress on the Cadillac Elescalade.
Elescalade.
Or would that be an Elescalade? Elescalade? Elescalade. This is going to be our battery box. We're going to do a couple of things somewhat unusually to the point where I'm sure I'll hear from them.
But very interesting, though.
I think
yeah.
so.
Yeah.
This is kind of like the Chevy Avalanche
mm-hmm.
As a pickup truck.
Mm-hmm.
I used to like that commercial. Somebody was trying to buy a newspaper and asked this guy if he had change. And he says, well, okay. And he changes his pickup truck all around and converts it from a front rear seat to a full pickup truck.
Uh-huh, uh-huh.
Our bed is 60 inches deep
mm-hmm.
and 50 inches wide. We had a local fabrication shop create for us an aluminum box that was ostensibly 49 inches wide. My 56 inches, leaving me 4 inches ostensibly to drill down through the bed
mm-hmm.
For some connections. And this box is going to do a couple of things a little bit unusually. Where can I start? First, they hit 50 inches. It just barely fits.
Right, right.
It was 49 at the bottom, but somehow it wound up being 50 inches at the top. But it's a nice, tight fit. It slides into the bed pretty nicely.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's it. We made it 14 inches tall. Our cells, the 400 Thunder Sky, the Winston Battery Company,
mm-hmm.
400 amp hour cells, are about 18 inches wide, about 100 millimeters thick, I think, and a little over 11 inches tall.
Okay.
So what we're going to do is put a false bottom in this for heating. As we said, we're going to heat our batteries, and that also gives us the possibility of cooling them
mm-hmm,
during
mm-hmm.
certain seasons. We're going to do that with liquid, and the material I'm hoping to use, largely because it's inexpensive and they use it a lot in home heating, is called PEX tubing.
And that's the radiant floor heating?
Radiant mm-hmm. floors, yeah. Mm-hmm. You'll have a boiler in your house,
mm-hmm.
and you simply run hot water through this. They can put it in concrete, but they, you know, clip it to the bottom of wood floors and so forth.
Okay.
It's a plastic. It doesn't conduct. It's relatively inexpensive.
Mm-hmm.
and it seems to transmit heat pretty well. For our purposes, to avoid a lot of connections, we've been experimenting with a heat gun.
Yeah.
And we found that we can bend it without kinks, and it will retain the bend when it cools.
Mm-hmm.
This is exactly a half inch in diameter.
Okay.
Now, the PEX fittings that they normally give you are a barb. And they're kind of a small one. This is ostensibly 3/8 tubing. Mm. But this barb is smaller than 3/8. And it slides on very easily.
Mm-hmm.
And you put a clip on there. I wanted 50 or 60 of these in the battery box. Like I need another girlfriend to entertain my wife. This, and I can't really show it to you because I've already stuck it in here, and it's in pretty good even without a clamp. This is an AN6 fitting to 3/8 inch barb.
Okay.
Would you believe it's bigger than the barb for the 3/8 inch PEX tubing?
Hmm. Why is that?
Because the PEX tubing really isn't 3/8 ID,
mm-hmm.
but it's pretty close.
Mm-hmm.
And so if we heat up the PEX tubing, we can work that barb down in here, and we will put a clamp on it. What do you have there? There's one of the 3/8 barbs, and I happen to have my calipers here, so let's just check on the narrow dimension. This is 0.35. This being 0.31.
Just a little bit smaller.
Yeah, it's just a little bit smaller. Let's see. So if we heat this up, this will actually go in. This is an AN6 fitting to 3/8. And if I heat it up, it'll go into this 3/8 inch PEX. And when it cools, it won't come out. It's actually in there. Now we'll put a clamp on this.
Just for fun.
But it's really just for fun. That's just to give you something to do.
Yeah.
Because I don't think it'll come out. Now, if I heated this up, I could pull it right out. And we're going to do that. So the plan is to run this PEX tubing in the bottom in a serpentine fashion.
Okay.
Across the bottom. Get as much of it in there as we can. And then we need a fitting to get it out of the box. Going to lay there. As I said, the PEX is exactly a half inch thick. Down the street, I've got a couple old guys working on my steps. This is some, they call it color fast deck material. And one side's kind of like wood and the other side's smooth. It's sort of made out of milk cartons.
Right.
It is. It's recycled plastic. And we've gone to using it for steps and porches in some of these old buildings.
Because they never rot out.
It never rots, yeah. Right? Yeah. Bingo.
Mm-hmm.
And one other characteristic might that have that would be particularly attractive to me?
They're not going to expand if they got a little water on them or something like that. The mist, you know, the wood would kind of expand a little bit.
But if I put paint on this, it'll just fall off. So I can save my trouble. They come in different colors, brown and white and gray. And whatever color you buy, that's the one you get.
That's the one
you
get. Huh? Mm-hmm.
But it works out pretty good. So I don't ever have to paint them and they don't ever rot.
Mm-hmm.
So they're excellent for porches. Now this is half inch too.
Okay.
Except I knew that I could count on the building materials industry. If they tell you half inch, by God, they deliver a little less than that.
You mean like a 2x4?
Yeah.
An inch and a half
like
by 3.5?
Then it's a 2x4. So we're going to have these as floor supports. And we're going to have the PEX running between them. And the PEX is going to be just a touch thicker than the supports.
Okay.
And then we have another piece of aluminum that's 1/4 inch shy of our box size.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to lay that on top. What will happen then?
Well, hopefully it would suck the heat out into the water or use the heat from the water into the batteries.
Mm-hmm. It's going to just slightly deform our PEX.
Oh, yes, yes.
It'll be warm and a little bit soft. and it's going to mash down to whatever the height of this is. Mm-hmm. And I can tell you with my calipers that that half inch is one of those 0.438 half inches.
Okay.
And the PAX is the 0.50 style half inch.
Perfect. Okay.
And so that's really only 0.07. But it'll give us good contact between the PAX and the bottom of the aluminum. Mm-hmm. Now, what holds the aluminum false floor in? How about 57, 30-pound batteries? So we need pretty good support. Uh-huh. I like this, again, this ColorFast decking, C-decking, they'll call it down at the hardware store, and they all have it. It's that Weyerhaeuser makes it. It's just plastic milk cartons dyed and formed into decking. But we're going to put a bunch of these strips in the bottom, wind the PEX back and forth, mm-hmm. and use a heat gun to form that U in each end. And that will give us our bottom heater or cooler.
Without any fittings and anything mm-hmm. like that. Uh-huh.
You've cut me a couple of holes here.
Yeah.
This is from Summit Racing. And this is a through bulkhead AN6 fitting. And it is my belief that you've got this hole just the right distance from the bottom of the box where this nut will sit here.
Nothing but perfection.
And I can just twist this in. And screw it in from the other side with the flat of the nut in the bottom of the box.
And you only need one wrench?
I don't really need a wrench right now. I'm just doing it with my fingers. We can tighten that down all we want. Mm-hmm. Then our AN6 PEX fitting hits right here.
Perfect.
It's not. It's nice, but it's not perfect.
Could be lower?
Yeah, if I could get below the bottom of the box, mm-hmm. I guess it'd be perfect. Mm-hmm. But as it is, I'm going to wind up with this just a little bit higher. And this is hardware, not soft tubing, than my strip. And so we're probably going to have to put a small notch in our false floor.
Okay.
About an inch by half an inch. So it'll set down over that and not put pressure on that terminal, mm-hmm. which we don't want. What I'm trying to get to here, guys, is I don't want to be pulling 1,700 pounds of batteries out to get to a leak.
Right, right.
And so this, we're going to have a through-the-wall fitting, our AN6 here, that to PEX, no other joint in here. We're going to do it all with a heat gun mm-hmm. and bends. And then we're going to probably glue these down just on even spacing.
You bet. Mm-hmm.
And put the false bottom in, and we're done mm-hmm. with that part of it. Now, in the truck, we just have to hook up an AN6 hose. We're actually going to use AN8 to the box. And then a little adapter to step it down to AN6. Yeah,
just like a 90, it's going to come out and straight down?
Yeah, I would think so. We're going to cut a hole in the truck bed to feed that black nylon AN8 hose up. Mm-hmm. And a 90-degree fitting, like we've been using on our cooling systems, to hook it up. The truck is a little bit of a problem.
It kind of is. Right here.
Yeah, what did we find right here?
There's only one cross member from the transmission all the way back.
In the whole truck.
It's right here, right?
It's right here. I mean, I've got 4 inches and it's 2.5. But it kind of separates on the two sides.
Yeah.
So we measured in carefully 3.5 inches from the corners and put these.
And that should get us out of that little mess there. Yeah.
And so we'll have a false bottom about a half inch up from 14 inches, leaving us 13.5 inches.
Okay.
Our batteries are about 11.25 tall. And so now we have to connect to them electrically.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to put these in for now. I ordered the wrong ones after looking at my... you want to tell her to go away?
She might not come back.
That'd be okay. This is a through-wall battery terminal that I found down at Rebirth Auto. This is kind of interesting.
It looks familiar.
It does look familiar, doesn't it?
I just can't put my finger on it. Well, that one would probably either be one of the controllers. Probably the Soliton Junior.
The Soliton 1 or the Soliton Junior has these as the terminals for the thing. Now, I got to tell you, we're going to be running potentially 2,000 amps from this battery pack to those two controllers. Now, I'm okay with doing a foot or two of that at 2.0, but we're going to use 4/0 welding cable. It's this big around.
Yeah, it's some big stuff.
To connect the battery box to some forward terminals in the engine bay close to our controllers. And so this is a 3/8 inch terminal. They actually have a 1/2 inch terminal. We're going to go ahead and mount these on the box because I think the base is the same.
Okay.
But we're going to probably go to the 1/2 inch.
Might as well, yeah.
And we need those up fairly high. And we're going to spot those now inboard of our fluid fittings and see if we can get that on there pretty nicely so they clear the batteries, and inside we'll strap all our batteries together and run one cable to each terminal, and then on the outside we'll have a flat 4.0 terminal with a guard on it that drops that cable straight down, because it's very thick.
It's heavy cable stuff.
And we're not wanting to be doing a whole lot of this. We're going to drop down, go through a gland nut in the bed, and bend it forward underneath, run it up into the engine compartment, and connect it to some of those heavy terminal strips use. And we'll feed the Solitons, the chargers, everything from there.
Okay.
But to go from the bed up to where all the action is, we're going to use some very heavy cable. Probably overkill, but for 2,000 amps.
And you got a little length to go there, yeah, from the back of the truck up to the...
We're going to wind it with 10-foot of cable.
Right, right. And that's kind of long.
The heavier cable we use, the less resistance and the less problems there. And so that'll be our battery terminals. And then we're going to take some angle iron, something like this, and cut that and screw it into the sides.
Kind of give this a little bow, a little support.
No, not really. I mean, it'll stiffen up our box quite a bit. But the big purpose is then we have one final sheet that is the same size as the real bottom. And that will lay on top here. We'll drill and tap holes for those quarter inch long Phillips head screws like we did in the Mini.
Okay.
And so we can screw this down. I'm not going to have much cargo room in the back there.
No.
I'm going to wind up with what?
Yeah.
Maybe about this tall to put my groceries and stuff. It winds up being a lot of batteries to move this vehicle. Yes, I could put some underneath, and we may yet. But for 57 of them, this is going to be home. And basically, we'll have a Cadillac Elescalade hauling around a pretty big pack of batteries. Because at 7,500, 8,000 pounds, if our rule of thumb holds true, how much would that be per mile?
Yeah, I don't know yet. Right off the top of my head,
10 to 1. So if
the 10 to 1. Uh-huh.
Yeah, if it's 7,500 pounds, probably 750 watt hours per month. And coincidentally, we'll have about a 75 kilowatt pack. And
how'd that come about?
You know,
about something like that.
Just every car we do winds up having 100 mile max range, 80 miles safe.
Mm-hmm.
We have to go to extreme measures, as in redux, and we're going to be going to extreme measures on Cobra mm-hmm. to get a larger range.
Right.
But this battery chemistry, it comes up over and over again. I think we're going to wind up with the Elescalade with 100 mile max range.
Okay.
If we run them flat,
mm-hmm.
and about an 80 mile good range to drive the car.
Okay.
But I understand the Leaf can barely do that as well.
Yeah.
And the Volt,
it was like 70 miles or something.
The Volt's doing 30 miles, I hear.
Yeah, last I heard it was 35, and originally it was 40.
Mm-hmm.
So that's going down every day.
I read an interesting document this week that was apparently stolen from Tesla some time back, one of our viewers sent. But it had a very interesting tale, and we're going to set up an experiment to test this,
okay.
see if it applies to our batteries. Their concern was that these batteries lose capacity at 20% per year if you leave them standing fully charged.
Okay.
If you decrease that to 40 or 50% state of charge,
mm-hmm.
it reduces to 4% per year.
Hmm.
They were trying to figure out how to get people to park their car 50% charged.
I see.
And use a 100-mile range instead of the 240 that they were claiming. Again, it's the more range you have, that's good. You don't have to use
you
all.
You don't have to run it dead every time.
Right.
If to drive a week without plugging it in.
If they tell you that they have a 100-mile car, that's not really for you to drive 100 miles.
Mm-hmm.
If you'll drive that 50 miles a day,
mm-hmm.
they'll last a long time. And you're going to run that little car out if you hit 100 and 105 every day
every
trying
time.
To push it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the reality of electric cars today. I would love to be able to report that through some cunning driving techniques and some brilliant engineering, that the truth is that everybody can have a 200-mile electric car. It's almost unachievable with the batteries we have to work with.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And that battery chemistry will have to change for that to be otherwise.
Right.
Now, in a van, a pickup truck like this, plenty of room like in the Cobra, or like all the work you did on the Redux, cramming batteries in every nook and
pretty much every spot I could find a spot.
You did well with that.
Thanks.
It wouldn't have never occurred to me we'd get 57 batteries in that car,
mm-hmm.
but we did. So it'll go 150 miles extreme,
mm-hmm.
but that's where we're at. So okay. this is going to be one massive. A battery box in the back of a pickup truck, not down between the rails, but actually in the bed.
Yeah.
I wouldn't use the Elescalade for landscaping or anything much anyway, you know?
No. I think I had to peel the plastic off the bed
yeah,
to get
yeah,
this in there.
Yeah, I think so. it hadn't been used much.
Uh-huh.
I did change it once. That's the trick avalanche. You know, change mode.
Uh-huh.
I did that one time.
Okay.
and Matt was having a party playing with it.
You bet. It's pretty neat.
So
it's a very nice truck.
It is a nice truck, and it's it kind of gives me pause converting it to electric. But that's what I want, and I think what we're seeing after months of waiting on parts and things, we should mm-hmm. have the battery shortly. We've got this battery box going, the adapter plate. We're finally making a little bit of progress with the Elescalade.
You can see four EV grins in that thing.
And you know, that's a good point, Matt. All my cars have two seats.
Mm-hmm.
If my daughter and her grandson wants to go,
got to pick another car.
Pick a different car.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm not really a four-door sedan kind of guy. I'm 90% of my time in a car, I'm by myself or mm-hmm. with one person. But it is nice to have a full-size, big people car.
You bet. yeah.
And that's yeah. what the role the Elescalade will fill is because it has it's not a club cab. It's a full four-door.
Oh, yeah.
Full back seat bench and mm-hmm. fairly spacious
mm-hmm.
at that. And so we could carry five adults.
Comfortably.
Pretty comfortable. I wouldn't want a, you know, NBA basketball player in the center of the back seat, but by either door he'd be fine.
Sure.
So that's one of the roles we're going to fill. I do want the car to, with this kind of investment, to have a maximum range, and this will be our first time and the first EV I've heard of using a 400 amp hour battery.
True.
Courtesy of our sponsor, the Winston Battery Company, and they make some much bigger cells than that. In fact, we originally were talking to them about a 600 amp hour sulfur.
It's lithium sulfur, huh?
And I kind of have a little bit of a deal with them that after, you know, we do this and test it all out and see what the range is, maybe they're a little further along with their sulfurs and we can do a swap and a comparison in the same vehicle to see what difference sulfur makes.
Yeah.
And I think that'd be a good demonstration for them and a very interesting one for our viewers. Again, one of the issues is wintertime driving. We're going to keep the all-wheel drive.
Mm-hmm.
And we're having some further progress on the transmission concept that we'll be talking about in coming weeks. But in the wintertime, we've noticed the batteries are not really as friendly to us.
Especially in my van, you know, where I'm parked outside, mm-hmm. you know, all the time. Oh, man, you can see they sag further. You mm-hmm. plug them into the charger, they're almost up to full voltage, you know, charge voltage.
Uh-huh.
They act quite a bit different in power. Uh-huh. You know, I mean, a low-speed vehicle, I can still feel a big difference in power.
It was kind of sluggish.
Oh, it is. Yeah, you go up to the little hills and stuff, it usually just flies right up. It's cold. You ain't going up them hills. Uh-huh. Not very fast.
Well, I think on this vehicle, I want to be able to heat it, and we're going to do that with sort of, hopefully, some gentle heat, glycol water solution through PEX tubing in between these two bottoms. This is nothing you can melt.
Mm-hmm.
Decking and the two aluminum plates, that should gently warm those.
Right.
It also gives us another possibility. And we're probably going to do this as well, is we could very easily plumb in one of those little block heaters.
For sure.
And have it where you can plug this in at night.
No more frozen doors. Right. I mean, it would just kind of want to keep the cabin even warm.
The cabin would be nice and warm. Uh-huh, the batteries would be nice and warm. And off 120 AC.
Because you guys do run into that, the icing of the doors and stuff like that around here. That would kind of eliminate that.
Not in my garage so much.
Well, not in the garage, but when outside. Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah.
But it would. We just got heat in the garage this year.
Mm-hmm.
But that's the concept, is to have toasty, warm batteries in the winter. In the summer, we're not going to be running heat for any of it.
Mm-hmm.
But I do have a pump. And it would be a fairly trivial to modify it, if necessary, with a heat exchanger.
For sure.
For in the summer, mm-hmm. To make this a cooling system.
You bet.
All I have to do on the heat is just not turn it on.
Right, right.
And the pump still pumps, yep. And the whole thing it goes through there. I could cut in a little Denali heat exchanger underneath the truck in a trivial amount of time. And make this also cool the cells.
You bet.
So this is our first experiment in thermal management of LiFePO4 cells. We do not have the constraints that the Tesla does with the Panasonics mm-hmm. or Volt has with the LG.
These are much more forgiving, aren't they?
They are.
Yeah.
But what we have learned is that temperature does matter mm-hmm. as far as performance.
Mm-hmm.
And so this will be our first thing. So I guess our next step is we'll glue down some strips and start running our PECs.
Okay.
And I think I'm gonna go get you some more of this angle iron so we can start assembling the top.
Okay.
All right, good. This episode of EVTV is brought to you by the Winston Battery Company Limited, makers of high-capacity lithium-yttrium rare earth cells, including the popular 160 amp-hour model featuring cycle lives in excess of 5,000 cycles when discharged to 70%, the longest useful working life of any available battery of any chemistry. A leading battery technology scientist, inventor, and entrepreneur since 1995, Mr. Winston Chung envisions a new world of clean electric power for the dawn of a new era of electric vehicles. For your next electric vehicle design project, contact Winston Battery Limited. Energy for a bright future. We're back at the box.
Yep.
We have, Matt has painted the box black. Paint it black and it'll disappear.
Well, I almost lost it. I almost couldn't find it.
I couldn't find the box.
It took Carl and I 15 minutes to find it.
We just painted the sides, but in the back of the black Escalade, this will pretty much disappear.
Well, we're kind of liking that hammered paint.
Yeah. Yeah, the hammered, what is that, Rust-Oleum
hammered black.
Yeah,
it's a good look.
It kind of puts a little texture on it, so we don't have to do such a good job.
Yeah, really. I'm not much of a painter, but they seem to come out
like
all right.
Charlie says on that dry sheetrock, you want to use blow the texture on it.
Yeah, it covers up all the
And so we painted it black. We've installed our through the bulkhead AN6 fittings and a couple of battery terminals here up at the top. And this is pretty simple, kind of annoying, but this is the PEX tubing. And as I said, we found we could hit it with a heat gun and it would take on a curve. This is kind of like wrestling a snake in a box.
Yeah, kind of was.
As it turned out.
And
we're using weights from our...
Brake
to hold things down while they dry. We use some liquid nails, just some construction adhesive, to kind of hold these pieces of C-deck in position. And we're going to use some to kind of locate our PEX tubing. Once the false bottom's on, it'll all hold together pretty well.
Yeah.
What do we got? One, two, three, four, five, six, seven loops. It's not a real tight pattern or anything, but I think it'll make a nice heat sink and transfer heat from that liquid to
well, and to not have any fittings on all these, it was worth it. Yeah,
this looks a little sloppy, but it's I had a whole sack of elbows specifically designed for PEX. We didn't do that. On the ends, we've got our AN6 3/8 barb, and we had to heat it up to put that on it. And just as a little assurance, we put a little, just an ordinary hose clamp to hold it in place. So there aren't really any, we have two fittings inside the box, the two AN6 3/8. And so now this PEX tubing is only rated for about 180 degrees Fahrenheit.
Right.
But I think that'll be plenty for what we're doing. And so this should provide kind of a gentle heating action to our batteries, and hopefully it won't load our 14 kilowatts of electric heat down too much. But I think this will be a neat experiment. And about what we have to do left is we're going to notch out the false bottom.
Right.
For the two fittings. I think most of our batteries will be against this end. We'll have a little room on that end where the terminals are and so forth. That was kind of the plan at 56 inches. And so I think it's coming together pretty good.
Yeah.
Then we're going to put angle iron, and we have to put the false bottom in first.
Yep.
And then we're going to put one inch by 1 inch, 1/8 inch angle along the sides. And fit our top. Matt come up with kind of an interesting idea, and I like it. Of course, it's going to cost me money.
Helping you.
Well, yeah, we're looking at a piece of 3/4-inch polycarbonate, 50 by 60 inches. Of course, a non-standard size.
Of course.
They'll probably pay me to haul it off. Mm-hmm. But that would give us a clear top where we could readily inspect the batteries and so forth.
Your LED lights around the outside, give it a halo in there.
One of the reasons I like the idea is our terminals are fairly close to the lid.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to be setting things on top of this. If we made the lid out of non-conductive polycarbonate, that would actually probably be safer.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so that's probably what we'll do. The other thing we can do is use the same C-deck material on the bottom side of the polycarbonate, measured just to reach the top of the cells.
Oh, right. That's true. Yeah, it wouldn't sag down. Mm-hmm.
No, it's not that. It's in the, if we roll the truck over or something, this should all hold together as a pack.
We can still put it in another vehicle?
Well, perhaps. It won't. Well, they're not going to come out in my lap anyway.
Right.
It's a good practice to restrain your batteries.
Yes, it is.
I'm kind of bad about just throwing them in there and putting a lid on it. Mm-hmm. But it's little enough trouble to take one of these pieces of C-deck. It's non-conductive. It's very inexpensive. Simply make it the width, the thickness to the bottom of your lid,
mm-hmm.
and fit it to the lid, screw the lid down. Now you've restrained those cells, all of them, individually, and I think that would be a big play here.
You bet.
Okay.
It looks good.
Yep. We're inching along progress-wise on the Cadillac Elescalade massive box to hold 1,750 pounds of beautiful Winston Battery Company.
Yeah, thanks, Winston.
400 amp hour cells. We had kind of a mess with some construction adhesive and the PECs and so forth. We got it all down. And Matt notched us out some notches here to get around our plumbing on that end. We've got that in the box. And now we have a nice, flat, well-supported bottom. Our battery terminals, I believe, are about 11 and a half inches.
Okay.
11 and a quarter to the top of the terminal. And that'll put us right about here. And we're putting on our 1 by 1 inch by 1/8 inch aluminum angle.
And that really makes these boxes.
It really stiffens up the box,
yes,
doesn't it?
It does, yeah.
Everybody's always like, that aluminum's too light for that box. That's going to be kind of flimsy.
Mm-hmm.
But when you get it together, the sum of the parts kind of hold each other together.
You bet.
And it gets quite stiff. We put a top on this then, and this thing you can park a truck on.
Yep.
We want the minimum weight we can carry, but I did want to add this false bottom hot water system, and so from here on out, we'll put the top and just tap 1/4 inch by 1/2 inch screws like we did on the Mini Cooper, and just have a flat top. We'll start that way, but I'm looking around for some 3/4. 5/8 or 3/4 polycarbonate, mm-hmm. to do that clear part. That comes normally in a 48-inch width.
Of course.
And, of course, we're 50 inches.
Right.
So that could be interesting. We may have to do it in a couple of pieces, or we might, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
But we're pretty much pretty far along with that. That's the basic design of the box. We wind up with AN6. Connection here. We're very close to the bottom, but as you can see, our AN6 90 degree, the nut on it is smaller than the through the bulkhead thing, so that'll work fine. And here's our battery terminals, again, kind of close to the lid, another reason for the polycarbonate, but it'll be some time. We'll go ahead and do the lid and put the holes and so forth, but it'll be some time before we see a lid on this thing.
Yeah.
With the batteries in and all strapped up. So that's our Elescalade battery box. And it's the biggest one we've done.
One of the easiest.
Should hold 57.
Almost one of the easiest.
You know, the bigger they are, the easier they are. Right. We probably $585 fabrication costs through Southeast Fabricating. The PEX tubing is not expensive. Some fittings, some battery terminals, and some of this angle. And so I doubt we've got $650 in the box.
Right, right.
And that'll contain them. We'll be able to heat them. Once we have these, you know, fluid connections, we can cool them, we can heat them, we can, there's a lot of things we can do. It's kind of built into the box at this point. And it'll be our first experiment with thermal management, you know, on that scale. We've done a fan before, but in fact, we put it on the Mini. It never came on. No, it never comes on. I think I've got it set for 110 degrees. Came on one day when it was parked in the sun. I don't even think the batteries were hot. It was just the car got hot. And so, but I think it's the other end. It's not cooling. It's not getting rid of heat that we've encountered. It's that February, they're a little sluggish.
Oh, they are. Yeah.
And Matt noticed that the first thing with the little van.
Oh, man.
And
it's kind of a dog when it's been sitting out in the cold all night. You get in there, it's
Well, I think we're just going to fix that.
Okay.
All righty. Back to you, Chet.
Masterflux proudly presents the Sierra Series brushless DC variable speed electric compressors. The Masterflux family of compressors are up to 40% smaller and lighter than competing belt-driven DC automotive compressors. Masterflux uses rare earth neodymium magnets for longer life and greater efficiency. The robust rotary design is ideally suited for rugged EV applications. With a scroll-type compressor, the process begins with the refrigerant entering the evaporator from the suction side. Refrigerant then travels through a reed valve to the top of the compressor, where it is compressed at up to 8 times the incoming pressure before exiting out the discharge tube to the condenser. Masterflux compressors are available in 400 to 15,000 BTU per hour capacity range for multiple refrigerants, including 134A. Output can be manually adjusted using a simple 0 to 5 volt pot. Masterflux compressors are available to handle input voltages of 12 to 420 volts DC and come with a specific BLDC motor controller for each voltage range. The new Masterflux 2011 product catalog can be downloaded from their website at www.masterflux.com. Masterflux products are available in the U.S. from Revolt Custom Electric Vehicles, in Australia from EV Works, and in South Asia from EV World. Masterflux, the technically elegant choice for powerful electric air conditioning.
And
that's a big deal. This is a good battery box. We can't do anything without batteries in that vehicle.
You know, that's the, you know, one of the first things we do, and I tell everybody half of your project is going to be planning, placing, spacing, measuring, all about batteries.
Your batteries, yeah.
But you can't do much to the car till you get a pack in.
No. Can't test anything.
You can't. I get a pack in, get a 12-volt DC to DC converter on it, and now, and a charger, and now I can start, you know.
Things happen fast then. When you get all that in, you're almost ready to go.
You can kind of start testing things and trying things and so forth. Yep. This is our first attempt at thermal management. We did a fan on the Mini Cooper that never came on.
No.
And it has irritated me ever since because we had to cut out part of that little panel to accommodate the fan. And then we didn't
really need it, no.
And so that's, but in this case, we want an all-season vehicle, and particularly with that size of a battery pack, if that gets cold-soaked, it'll take a while to warm up.
To warm it up, yeah.
And so we want to be able to gently but powerfully warm those cells up to, and their optimum operating temperature is 25 degrees centigrade. Yep. What's that, about 75?
75, yeah.
Fahrenheit. And so we're going to do that box and do some heating with the environmental. If I need heat, the batteries do.
Yeah.
but also probably a little block heater and an AC pump to gently heat it overnight.
To keep them warm overnight.
Keep them warm overnight.
Yeah.
And I think that'll make a big difference in January and February. And it will be worth the, if we get them up to temperature overnight off the wall, it's not going to take much battery to keep the things warm. We're going to have to keep me warm anyway.
Yeah.
And you're almost just doing waste from that to warm the batteries. And so I think that'll be a good system if we did need to cool the batteries. Once you have those Summit Racing fittings going every which way.
Yeah, once it's plumbed,
cutting
it's not
in,
that big a deal.
You know, a cooler in the summer is not that big a deal.
No.
Let's talk about the contest a little bit.
All right.
This is dragging out forever, but we can even talk about why a little bit. I got two nominees back from Josh Stillwalt.
Oh, a recharge car.
Recharge car has made their selections, and kind of took both of them off my short list.
Okay, good.
And they apparently read through the whole thing. Some of our sponsors are struggling with this. As I said, it was a lengthy document. We have things down a little shorter today. Yeah. I'm going to read, actually. This would make great video, me reading text into the screen. But I want you to get a sense. We've learned a lot from this contest and the entries, and I want to share some of that, maybe in little doses.
Okay.
We'll announce two of the finalists each show as we get them in from the sponsors, and kind of share with you basically their write-up on the final two questions and what we're thinking and looking at when we're doing this. The first finalist, and this is an official finalist nominated by Recharge Car, is Ralph Tate of Carterville, Illinois.
All right, Ralph.
Congratulations, Ralph. You're one of our finalists. Let me read you what Ralph did as an entry, and it was not a long one, but it is quite appealing. He says, since I'm about 95% finished with my first build, I have been thinking about what to convert next. I know that my first build is not ideal, but it meets the design goal of a greater than 25-mile range commuter. Now I'd like to build an EV with more of a performance focus, better acceleration, and greater range. I would also like to get my students, I'm an electronics technology professor, involved in the next conversion. These components, along with a suitable donor car, would cover most of the materials for an awesome school project. This would be a valuable asset to our technology program and would allow us to further develop an alternative renewable energy technologies curriculum while giving us the means of attracting and retaining students with an interest in EV tech. I know that most of my current students have been following my first conversion, and I have shared the process through demonstration and lecture. There is much interest, but little support, as the state can barely cover my damn salary these days. How long has it been since I've had a salary? I've spent a lifetime in technology R&D. I started as an electronics technician, went back to school, and finished a MSEE degree while serving in the military, and eventually became an internationally published research scientist in the field of high-energy lasers.
Okay.
I started my first EV conversion 1 year ago as a bonding project with my 80-year-old father, a master mechanic in his day. We had a blast doing the project and grew closer than we've ever been. We were both ecstatic when we took the EV for the first drive and encountered no problems. I designed the electrical systems for the EV, and even though I've worked as an engineer, I had to hit the books again and again to get up to speed on the technology. I know how it is, Ralph. It was an enjoyable and productive quest for knowledge, and EVTV provided much information. Thank you, Jack, for providing such valuable service to the EV community. Well, you're quite welcome, Ralph.
All right, Ralph.
And that last gratuitous was not, I'm sure, the reason that he was selected. Let's talk about a couple of things. Anytime, you know, people give away something, or see, have I got all my pages here? Brain, I've lost a page.
Uh-oh. What's the...
This is not good. When you're giving away something like this, you look for leverage. People don't just give things away at random. They want to have an impact on something. And one of the leverages here is that Ralph has this class and these students and is trying to do a curriculum on energy. And so were he to win it, that gets us not only an impact with Mr. Tate, but also with some young people who have an interest in this. And so that's a big plus, I think. His background as an engineer leads us to probably some likelihood of success. Mm-hmm. And I'm a sucker for the father-son project.
Yeah.
And we had a number of these proposed.
Yeah.
And they're not what I thought. This is not actually usually fathers and sons where the son is 15 and the dad is the dad.
Right.
What I'm seeing is a lot of totally grown adult people who are trying to reconnect with their father after he's retired, mm-hmm. and they're adults, and do the father-son thing almost right. in reverse with the 80-year-old father and the not even a whole lot younger son.
Yeah.
And we had a lot of entrants like that, and I think those are very good. And so that was one of the entrants and my thoughts on it. But I did not pick him. This was John Stillwell. And Recharge Car picked Ralph. But I think it was an excellent selection. He's probably got a little bit of an advantage over some of your other finalists in that he has a school. And they have school websites and stuff. And I'm sure he'll campaign a little bit to get the students to help vote. We're not going to open the voting until all the finalists are posted on the website and selected. So I guess school's out.
I bet he can get a hold of them.
But I bet he can get a hold of them. Our other Recharge Car nominee is actually Mark Eamon of St. Michael's Winery in St. Michael's, Maryland. And we have corresponded with Mark in the past. He actually sent us some wine one Friday, and we featured it on the show. This was a year or two ago, but he's so I'll go over his a little bit. I have purchased a 1973 Porsche 914 for my EV project. The car is in very good running condition and is licensed as an everyday driver. Custom license plate, EV smile.
All right.
To start the project, I have equipped the car with low roll resistant tires, 45 PSI, and Fuchs rims. Is that right?
Fuchs.
Yes.
Yeah, are the 914 rims. Yeah,
those are quite commonly lightweight.
Yeah, lightweight rims for 914s, yeah.
Rebuilt every single component of the braking system, including larger master cylinder and large caliper and pads. I run St. Michael's Winery, located about 1.5 miles from my home. Well, he'll need an extended range.
At least 3 miles then.
So the 50 cells won't do it, but it'll be a start. Yeah, I know I should walk, run, or ride a bike to work, but we also have a warehouse about 5 miles from the house, and the nearest big town with Lowe's and Target, your two basic staple suppliers,
what else do you need?
Is 12 miles away. So the EV will serve my needs extremely well. But wait a minute. My wife, Lori Cuthbert, is the editor-in-chief of Discovery Channel's online science news site, discoverynews.com. Yes, I am dropping names and doing everything I can to win this sucker. Fair enough. Lori works in her home office 4 days a week in St. Michael's, Maryland, but one day a week she has a 170-mile round-trip commute to the mothership, Discovery Channel.
Okay.
near Washington, D.C., in Silver Spring, Maryland. So I want to build a car that she can use for this commute. My idea is to build a practical long commute car that will serve to begin to eat away at the range anxiety issue. So I will probably add more batteries to the project, which I am more than happy to fund. Also, assuming car can charge all day at Discovery, ideally on display in the lobby. Yes, before the winery, I was a video producer for Discovery, happy to pitch this build to them and the use of the commute as a show. Another thing that excites me is to improve the everyday drivability of the ICE 914 by adding air conditioning. Your struggles with the Mini air conditioning and the fact the Speedster is only a fair weather car prompted this train of thought. Mm-hmm. The 914 has the hard target top, so essentially converts into a hard top with a very small area of air to condition. It is hot and muggy in the DC area in the summer. Of course, running the air will mean even more battery power for the 1.5-hour commute. So that is the dream. A classic 914 that performs as well or better than the original, adds significant creature comfort, and has a very respectable range. Of course, I have already added a nice Sony radio with Bluetooth and USB ports front and back. Thought about the video screen, but passed it up because when my 7-year-old son rides in the car, I want him to look out the window, not at the screen, and the 914 has excellent rear vision. Cheers, Mark.
All right. Interesting.
And then he says, major media connections. Run a winery with 30-amp 220 plug outside and sign that says reserved for electric car parking. Successful career in major media in my 30s, Discovery, National Geographic, NPR. Successful career in wine in my 40s, 47 this month.
Okay.
Plan on making a successful career in electric cars in my 50s.
Oh.
It is simply the right thing to do, and Jack, you are right. The big auto manufacturers won't and can't get it right or fast enough. When I was in my teens, I spent all my time putting headers and thrush mufflers and bigger carbs and camshafts and intakes on V8s and muscle cars. It is my dream that my 7-year-old boy, when he is driving in 9 years, is busy programming his charger and controller and experimenting with new batteries to get his hot rod going faster and better, troubleshooting his electric car and avoiding the hazards will be just as second nature to him as it is to me when I look at the simple, no computer gas engine in this old 914.
Mm, okay.
Mark, you hit all the hot buttons here, buddy. What don't we like about Porsches?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right. Starting with the
here donor. The Motorverse.
That's right, starting with the donor car.
Starting with the car.
Yeah.
And you'd be amazed how many entries we had that they were either going to do a pickup truck or a spaceship or something.
Yeah, something. Yeah.
If they didn't know what they wanted to convert, what was I supposed to tell them?
Right.
So having a specific vision
helps,
of what you're going to do is a big play. And then the Discovery Channel is not the big appeal to me anyway. I'm sure he'll have his build on the Discovery Channel. We're kind of going a little different direction, Mark. We're kind of globally distributing video in kind of how I see it being done in the future. And 45% of our viewers right now aren't in the United States.
Right.
But I am attracted to your experience as a video producer in that one of the things I would like to have out of this, whoever wins, is kind of some video updates on the build that we could include in the show, like we do Dwayne Ball's 904 and so forth. That would be something that would work
for
me.
Cool. Yep.
The air conditioning is interesting. One of our sponsors is Masterflux. They do the compressor we used in the Mini Cooper. The Mini Cooper at this point does work quite well.
Yes.
We had a problem that was solved by a diode, believe it or not.
Yes.
Very interesting problem. The car would work in air conditioning great in the garage. We'd take off down the road and it'd blow a fuse.
Yeah.
If we did that enough and used enough fuses, we'd blow up the controller.
Blow up the controller, yeah.
As it turned out, the controller for the air conditioner had a series of input capacitors mm-hmm. to take the ripple out from the pack. And we'd go out, we'd be at 375 volts. The caps would charge 375 volts. We'd go out on the road and I would step on the accelerator. The pack would instantly sag to 345 volts.
Mm-hmm.
Well, there's 375 volts in these caps.
Yep. They were trying
so these four little caps
are trying to help.
I get teary thinking about it.
I know. We killed them. They were working so hard.
Are discharging, trying to drive my car for me.
They were working so hard.
Backwards through the fuse and would blow the fuse.
Yeah. I couldn't believe it.
And Marcus Siegert, I believe, suggested a diode.
Yes.
And I thought, a diode, now what's that going to do?
Yeah.
I thought, wait a minute. You know, it's not that hard to try.
No.
I happen to have a little 50-amp diode here.
Yeah.
I can just bolt that on, and immediately the thing worked great. This was news to Revolt, our distributor on the Master Flux. Turns out it was kind of news to the...
It was news to Tecumseh.
To Tecumseh. I mean, they do a lot of things for the trucking industry and the marine industry. Mm-hmm. Typically a 12-volt static system. An electric vehicle is actually a little bit of a new deal.
Yeah.
And that we stomp on the accelerator and go from 250 volts to 200 in mm-hmm. one, you know, half a second.
Yep.
They had simply had no experience with
it. Right.
They now recommended a diode and it had provide a part number for you to do that. But as a sponsor of the show, you're going to receive this Masterflux compressor. And once you get past the diode issue, I think you're going to find it very mm-hmm. capable. One of the things I like about it is it's very adjustable. You can use this as a 4,000 BTU compressor. You can use it as a 14,000 BTU compressor.
Mm-hmm.
And you can dial that in with a pot.
Yeah, yeah. And it's really flexible.
So you can pick whatever evaporator you want and whatever condenser you want.
Whatever system you have, yeah.
And however badly you do that, you can tune the compressor where it'll work.
Yeah, yep.
And so I think you'll like that. But yeah, that looks pretty good, and we're hoping that's a very ambitious build goal mm-hmm. as well. 170 miles. Now he's talking about charging
at one end. Yeah,
at one end, but yeah. Still, 170 mm-hmm. would be. 85 miles one way, and so he's got to build a probably 110-mile car, 120-mile mm-hmm. car to do that without
do it safely,
you know, and to maintain his batteries and so forth. And I think it could be done. A 914 is a little bigger Porsche than we're used to fooling with, isn't it?
Yeah, it's mid-engine, so it's got room both in the front and rear trunks.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean,
it's got a back seat too, doesn't it?
No,
it doesn't. It's a mid-engine. That's
mid-engine.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So he may be able to do it.
Yeah, he might be. The so that's congratulations
yes,
to both of those.
Congratulations.
Brian, you came up with 10 names that you're recommending. We haven't made our selections and can't tell our sponsors to because
right.
we don't know how much overlap
there's
going to be.
Yeah.
Did I include your list of 10 in here?
Yeah, but I think... You know, since these names may not come up, I mm-hmm. guess the thing that I was looking for was, you know, one thing if it came through, because they did get to write an essay, was some passion, mm-hmm. as well as some idea of what they, as you were describing, what they wanted to build.
Mm-hmm.
You know, did they have a build-in project? You know, the and passion was a big deal, because people can learn. They mm-hmm. didn't have to be engineers, as
right,
far as
right.
I was concerned.
Nope.
We're not, and don't plan on it, you know, going out and getting a master's in electrical engineering. But I think it could come through that you have a certain understanding
mm-hmm.
of what the scope of the project was going to be, the donor vehicle, passion. And if they said Jack and Brian, that did they mentioned my name in there, I gave them an extra little bonus.
You like that?
Yeah.
You like that when they talk about you?
But that was really what I was looking for, was passion, commitment. I think, you know, it's hard to tell if there's an ability there, but I was looking for someone that had the vehicle already, mm-hmm. maybe had some mechanical skills as well.
Mm-hmm.
There's really a lot of things I think that's
that are going to add up to some the success for the person.
I like to see some past accomplishment.
Mm-hmm.
I like to see some proven track record of mm-hmm. success,
mm-hmm.
a detailed vision of what they want to do,
right,
and convince me that that would actually get done,
mm-hmm.
and perhaps that it would matter.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I mean, we had a lot of people wanting to do a perfectly rational S10 a Ranger conversion,
mm-hmm.
but we're going to have another S10
or
Ranger.
A lot. Yeah.
Mark Eamon, for example, makes a pretty persuasive case. He had a successful career as a video producer.
Mm-hmm.
He's currently in a successful career as a wine producer,
mm-hmm.
and he wants in his 50s to be a car conversion shop.
Yeah, car conversion shop, which a lot of our viewers...
Now, what would lead me to believe he wouldn't be successful?
I think he would. He's done changed careers and been successful,
mm-hmm.
and had completely different careers.
He has a very specific image of a car,
mm-hmm.
and I might touch this guy, and he touch 1,000 others.
All right.
And that's the kind of leverage that we're talking
right,
about.
Exactly.
So we're going to continue going through them. We should, I think, certainly be able to cough two a week for the next couple of weeks.
Yeah.
And Chris is going to get him a web page. We're going to solicit their further videos. Ralph and Mark, I would like to take this opportunity to already invite you mm-hmm. at your expense, and if you want to do it, and it's certainly not necessary, but we are available. You may come here and make the pitch directly to our viewers into the camera,
mm-hmm.
and we'll throw you softball questions while you do that.
Yeah, that's right.
Maybe some hardball ones.
Some Katie Couric questions.
Mm-hmm. You bet. And so you two are invited, as we are going to for all the finalists. You could come here to Cape Girardeau, be on camera, and talk to our viewers directly,
mm-hmm.
and
Absolutely.
Explain to them why they ought to vote for you,
yep.
to get the components. And so, but we will have a website with web pages for each of the individual finalists.
Yep.
They can post videos. They can post pictures of the car. They can post pictures of a sample. What they propose it would
what
look like
vision,
at the
yeah,
end.
That, yep.
Drawings, text, descriptions of themselves. Curriculum vitae.
Yeah. Kids, dogs, parrots.
Kids,
anything.
Dogs, parrots, and anything they. They think they can, that might help. And Christopher Fisher has promised to help them gain access to that page and any
cool.
Design help they might need or implementation. And so that'll be part of the process. So congratulations,
yes, congratulations.
Mr. Ralph Tate and Mr. Mark Eamon.
Yep.
We're still beating up our other sponsors for more.
We'll get them. Yeah.
We'll get them.
Yep. All right.
Well, if we don't, we're just going to name them.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
So either way, in the next few weeks,
we've got a few. Everybody's
have
got
the
a few
full
in their
set
pocket.
Of finalists,
yep.
And I think this is going to be a fun contest, fun voting. Now that we've got it down to I'm down below a 100-page document.
Yep.
I'm wrestling yep. with, and yep. you've got it down to 10. Yep. Matt's named 10. And yep. And we're going to sort it down further, but it gets pretty tough at this point.
Yeah.
A lot of passion for the genre, big plans for the future,
mm-hmm.
some very interesting projects, not all mm-hmm. of them even cars, and I'm kind of partying like a rock
yep.
star with
it's been
this.
Fun.
The okay, well, that's about it for our Thursday show.
Our Thursday show.
Next week, we'll be in Carlisle, Pennsylvania, and you will not get a video show.
No.
I normally edit on Saturday and post on Sunday. We'll be back probably Monday.
Yeah.
And so by Tuesday or Wednesday
yeah.
the following week, I should have something up with some video of Carlisle, Pennsylvania.
Yeah.
We'll be seeing several of our viewers out there. I know Tom Alvary has said mm-hmm. he's going to come by on Friday and so forth. So weather and floods and so forth permitting, we're going to depart next week and go to Carlisle, Pennsylvania with 3 Porsches. And so a little delay in next week's show, but stay with us. And for this week, I'm Jack Ricker, EVTV.
And I'm Brian Noto.